Good morning, everyone. I am so glad to see you all online once again. If I've not had the chance to meet you, my name is Michelle Dresser, and I am one of the interns here at GVBC. If you are new, welcome. We are so happy that you chose to join with us online this morning. Now, this month, our church has been going through a movement called 31 Days of Prayer through Ephesians. Each day has contained a passage from Ephesians, as well as a personal prayer from GVBC, and an invitation to pray on your own as well. If you've been trekking with us this long, we are on day 16, which means we are halfway through. Now, this morning, I want to go ahead and read today's passage, which comes from Ephesians 4, 7 through 13. So if you have a Bible, I encourage you to go ahead and open up to that passage with me. If you don't, that's okay. The passage will be on the screen right here. But at this time, I just want to invite you to go ahead and read the passage aloud with me. So wherever you are in your homes, let's go ahead and read together, starting at verse 7. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and gave gifts to men. What does he ascended mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. It was he who gave some to the apostles, some to the prophets, some to the evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Would you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, we just praise you for the grace that we have received through Christ Jesus. God, we praise you that through your mercy, we have been equipped to do your good works. And so as we enter into worship this morning, God, I just pray that you fill us with your spirit. God, that you would unite our hearts as one body, one church, Lord, in worship to you. God, so we lift up this morning to you and we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Would you please join with me in worship?
Good morning, Gardena Valley Baptist Church. I'm Pastor Daniel. I got Teresa Louie and Jason Toy with me, and we're here to lead our congregation in worship this morning. Glad you're here to join us as we worship God in song. And as we sing these first couple songs, they're going to be on the cross. And the cross is something that, while at the time, it was an ugly, it was a disturbing, it was a horrifying event. And yet, here on this side of the cross, as we are the church of Jesus Christ, it's a wonderful thing for us. It's a wondrous thing because it represents God's grace to us. It levels the playing field, and all of us, no matter our background, we're one. And so we have an opportunity to come before God in that oneness and to realize that God has made us useful for him and for his glory. And so as we sing these songs, let's just praise God as we sing about the wonderful cross.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss. so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, bids me come and die and find that I truly.
Cross.
Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross,
that were an offering far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became old. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And here I am to worship. Here I am to to me. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
God, we thank you for the wondrous cross.
And Lord, we thank you that
you stepped down into darkness and became light in order that we might have hope, that we might have purpose, that we might be able to be useful for your purposes, Lord. So we want to worship you this morning, and we thank you for who you are. God, we love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, worship team. So right now, we're going to go ahead and hear a few announcements, and the first is for our young adults. Here at GVBC, we have 4 young adult community groups that meet throughout the week, and really this is just a great time to fellowship and connect with one another. So the first group we have meets on Monday nights at 7:30 p.m. on Zoom, and this is led by Ryan Aratsu. The second group is our Tuesday community group, which meets at 7 p.m. on Zoom, and this is led by Amy Komai, Brandon Tasaki, and Tommy Park. The third is our midweek community group, which meets on Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. on Zoom, and this is led by the Yorks and the Hiokis. And the final is our Japanese-speaking young adult group, which meets on Sundays at 9 a.m. on Zoom, and this is led by Tommy and Yumi Morris. So if you're a young adult and you would like to go ahead and get connected, you can do so by contacting Tracy Orizane or Kyle Campbell. And next, we want to celebrate our 2020 graduates. So if you want to send a quick congratulations into our live chat, you can go ahead and do that now as we take a quick look at this year's graduates.
I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I've been changed from a ruin to treasure. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, letting go and trusting.
So once again, to all our graduates, congratulations, and we are so excited to see what God has for you in store in the future. Now, to transition a little bit, church, I also want to share with you some difficult news. This past Tuesday morning, Dora Sato passed away after suffering from a stroke the week prior. Please be in prayer for Dora's son, Roger Sato, along with the other family members. The family will be holding a private service at Green Hills, and Pastor Daniel will be officiating. Additionally, Nancy Murai passed away on Friday, August 14th, due to age-related health concerns. Please be in prayer for Nancy's husband, Jim, and their family during this time. And lastly, as we enter into a time of offering, we just want to thank you for the ongoing support that you have shown to the GVBC ministries during this pandemic season. If you would like to continue to support the work that God is doing here, you can go ahead and do so by mailing a check to GVBC or donating online at gvbc.net/donate. Would you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, We just thank you that you remain a good God in all seasons. Lord, we praise you for our graduates. We thank you for the ways that you have just taken them through their schooling, Lord. And we look forward in excitement to the things that you have for them. Lord, we also mourn with the families of Dora and Nancy, God, and we just pray for peace and comfort as they grieve and they process during this time. Lord, and we also want to praise you and thank you for the ways that you have continued to sustain us during this pandemic season. God, may the offering that we give to you today be a blessing to your ministry, God. And with the ways that we use this offering, equip your servants, God, to be useful for your purpose. Lord, we thank you and we praise you and we lift this worship up to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Would you please continue with me in worship today?
We're going to sing Glory to God Forever. And as we sing the chorus, glory to God, glory to God, I want to encourage you to lift your voice, lift your hands if you want to, sing this out from the bottom of your heart. And we get to that bridge where it says, take my life and let it be. Let it just be this offering of love to the Lord for all that he has done in our lives.
You spoke it to be. You were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were. Yeah, you were. And now your reign is still enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out. We join them as we sing. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. So I could praise your great and matchless name all my days, so let my whole life be a blazing offering, a life that shouts and sings the greatness of our King. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God.
Take my life
and take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. And take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours.
Sing that again. Take my life
and take my life and let it be.
To God.
Good morning, church. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Jonathan Ikemoto, and I'm part of our college ministry here at GVBC. This is my first appearance in front of the camera, but if you realize it or not, I've been blessed to play a small part in filming main service ever since the first time we went online in March, from behind the camera. For those of you who don't know, I've been blessed with the opportunity to serve the church by being one of the people who have been filming and editing alongside Michelle Dresser for main service. Alongside helping them film and edit from main service, I also film and edit the college group messages that go live on YouTube each Sunday. During this time, I've seen how God continues to move through my life and through the lives of other people that I get the chance to serve with. God has been teaching me that prayer should be my first line of offense, not my last line of defense, and that I should continue to trust in His plan and have faith in Him during this time. This morning, I'll be reading out Philemon 1, 8 through 16. So if you have your Bibles, I encourage you to turn there with me. It says, "Therefore, although in Christ, I can be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I prefer to appeal to you on the basis of love. It is as none other than Paul, an old man and now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ, that I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he has become useful to both you and me. I am sending him, who is my very heart, back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me, so that he can take care of your place in helping me while I'm in chains for the gospel. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that any favor you do would not seem forced, but would be voluntary. Perhaps the reason he was separated from you for a little while was that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. He is very dear to me, but even dearer to you, both as a fellow man and as a brother in the Lord."
Welcome again, everyone, to Gardena Valley Baptist Church's worship service. I'm Pastor Doug, and I'm going to share with you again from Philemon. We're in our second week looking at the letter to Philemon with the theme of being reconciled. Has there been a more urgent time in our nation, in our country, in this pre-election time that we should be thinking and praying about being reconciled? Reconciliation happens between people, and it happens with our relationship with God, and those two themes are obviously intertwined together. So we're talking about being reconciled, and this morning, Jonathan did a great job of reading verses 8 through 16. He has a great voice, doesn't he? So 8 to 16 we're looking at, and I just want to mention to you that if you were to have lived like in England in 1820, you would have received about 3 letters a year, and you probably would have written about 3 letters a year. That kind of was the average. And all those letters would have been written and sent without cover. That means without an envelope. It took a British citizen by the name of William Mulready to go on vacation in France one year when he noticed that letters were sent in what the French called an envelope. It comes from the French word to wrap. And he thought, what a great idea, keeps everything private. So he comes back to the UK and he introduces sending letters in an envelope, and it really took off and people loved it. Philemon wished that Paul had not sent a postcard that everyone could read. He wished that this had been sent in an envelope. Because what Paul does is he actually circumvents the social and cultural norms of the day to move this whole discussion about what was regarded as human property, slaves, into a Christian value system, worldview, and Christian identity. He shifts it all into a different place. Now, a runaway slave in Italy was nothing new. It didn't make the headlines, let me tell you that. Very common thing to happen, especially with the millions and millions of slaves in the empire. Slave catchers were hired to track these poor souls down, mark them, connect with the owner, the master, and collect their fee. Oftentimes there are advertisements for a missing slave. Archaeologists have actually discovered collars that slaves would wear. One such caller says, I'm Asaleus, slave of Praesitus, who is an official in the Department of Grain Supply. I have escaped my post. Detain me, for I've run away. Take me back to the barber shop near the Temple of Flora. That was the collection point where they collect this guy. But let me ask you something. What are the chances that a slave who belonged to a key leader in a church that Paul had connections with and knew Paul, what are the chances that that slave would run into Paul in the most populous city in Italy, Rome? And what are the chances that a criminal, supposed criminal in chains, Paul would go to a warden and say, hey, you know, this fellow convict of mine over here, I want to send him back to his master. What right or authority does Paul have to be sending a slave back to its owner? They would use legal channels to do that. Paul has no say in this. The warden would have said, you know, I'm going to put you in solitary confinement. You need to keep your mouth shut. I mean, what are you talking about? You have no say or authority in this. So we have to think, what's going on here? Notice that verse 10 says that while I was in chains, he becomes a father to Onesimus. He didn't say anything about Onesimus being in chains. We just sort of assume that Onesimus is also in prison with Paul, but that actually may be not exactly right. There may be another way to look at this story, and that is that Onesimus had come to be a follower of Jesus through maybe one of the local house churches in that area, and through that had come into Paul's orbit and got to know Paul. Now we're getting into the meat of things, aren't we? After the introduction, now we're getting into the heart of things, and it gets a little stickier. So in verse 8, Paul says, therefore, in Christ, I could be bold enough to order you what you ought to do. Now, can you imagine that Philemon's reading this letter and saying, okay, wait, what is this letter about? He's talking about ordering me and being bold. Being bold, by the way, is a word that they would commonly use for Greek city-states citizens who had the right to speak the word. I could speak it fearlessly, openly, freely, because I had the right to do that. But wait a second, Paul and Philemon are citizens of another kind of kingdom. And in that kingdom, which is in Christ, by the way, Paul would have the authority and right as Philemon's spiritual father to, in fact, order him. And it's clear that that order means a word spoken by someone who is superior and he can speak authoritatively. So as we look at this, he says, but I'm going to do something different. I'm going to appeal to you, verse 9, on the basis of love. And if we had looked at verse 5 and verse 7, Paul very deliberately is using persuasive language, mentions Philemon's love for God's people. So he's already mentioned it twice, even before he gets here to this point in the letter. This letter is very carefully constructed to persuade, to make an appeal. And what he's saying is, I want to make my appeal based on love. That is the one thing that should guide and govern all Christians' communications, relationships, our dealings with each other, and even with the world, which doesn't behave that way. But that is the ground of my appeal, and it's precisely because you, Philemon, have demonstrated that love, I know that I might then be able to make an appeal on those grounds rather than demanding your obedience. And by the way, let me remind you of several things he says to him. In one sentence, he does three things. It is none other than Paul. In other words, this is not a stranger. This is Paul, someone you know, someone you have a history with, someone you have a relationship with. None other than Paul, an old man. By the way, we guesstimate, taking the different pieces of New Testament history that we have available to us, that at this stage, that Paul was probably about between 57 and 63. And in the ancient world, that was old. He was an old guy. And so he's appealing now to Philemon's sympathy. I'm not going to make a whole lot more requests from you, probably. I'm not going to live much longer. So this is not going to come at you again and again. And oh, by the way, I'm a prisoner. Not just any prisoner. I'm a prisoner of Christ Jesus. In other words, I'm a prisoner because I am suffering for Christ. I'm suffering for preaching the gospel. And that also should say something to you. So Paul, someone you know, I'm an old man and I'm a prisoner of Christ Jesus. All things trying to appeal to him. And I want to appeal to you for my son Onesimus, who's become a son while in chains. And it's interesting, as you read that verse, if you were to read it in Greek, you'd actually see that the name Onesimus is at the very, very end of that verse. Let me ask you something. Is there someone's name that you would prefer never to hear again? You hear that person's name and you kind of want to grind your teeth. It just makes you stressed, makes you angry, maybe makes you bitter. You know, if I never heard of that person again, because it triggers memories, it just makes you feel a certain way you don't want to feel. As soon as you hear that name, and this is probably the first time since Onesimus ran away that Philemon is hearing that name and seeing him. And he's going to feel all sorts of things, and probably not a whole lot of it is good, but he's reading here that Onesimus has become Paul's child, is actually literally the word in Greek, but son because of his gender. His son. He's been converted because he's been around Paul and that Christian community in Rome. And he's someone who's very dear to him. And all that language gears off, okay, something has happened here. What has happened here? Philemon's thinking, he's making an ask of me. We haven't quite got to that yet. But something's happened and something significant has happened. And so with delicate tact, Paul is introducing Philemon to the change that has happened in his property, in a slave, a person. And in describing Onesimus as a child or as a son, Paul is using language that he frequently uses in 1 Corinthians 4 and 2 Thessalonians 2. He uses the words, 1 Thessalonians 2, I'm sorry, where he says, hey, you know what? I am your father. I'm your spiritual father. I've treated you that way. I'm the one who brought you into the faith. And he's using that idea to communicate a certain something to Philemon to cause him to think. He was formerly useless to you, but now he's become useful both to you and to me. And of course, what he's doing is he's making a pun. Onesimus means useful in Greek. And so he's doing a play on words. It's a sharp contrast between what Onesimus was and what he is now. By the way, we believe Onesimus was from an area called Phrygia, which is in the middle of Asia Minor, which is current-day Turkey. And they had a reputation. They were infamous for being unreliable and unfaithful. So Onesimus was completely useless, apparently up to this point. But Paul says, no, wait, a change has happened. He's useful not only to me, but also to you. Philemon's going to think, okay, well, what do you mean? He wasn't great before, so what are you getting at? Roy Riggles played football for Cal. They played Georgia Tech in the Rose Bowl one year. And Roy played linebacker. A fumble, Georgia Tech fumbled the ball. Roy picks up the ball, but as he picks it up, he is hit and he's kind of spun around, so he's disoriented and he starts running for the goal line. He's got a fumble. He's got a turnover. He's going to score a touchdown. He's running and running and running, and he gets to the one-yard line. He's tackled from behind by one of his own teammates because he's running to Georgia Tech's goal line. He was going to score for them, and he didn't know it because he was so disoriented. Halftime came right after that play. Everyone goes into the Cal locker room, and it's dead quiet, except for Roy sitting in the corner with a towel over his head crying. At the end of halftime, the timekeeper comes in and says, you only got 3 minutes left. And coach stands up and says, okay, everyone who played in the first half, you're going to play in the second half. And all the team goes running out, except for Roy, who's still crying in the corner of the locker room. And the coach goes over to Roy, and Roy says, look, I've ruined this. I've let you down. I've let the team down. I'm completely worthless. I can't go back out there. Coach said, you know what? You're going to get back out there, and you're going to play your heart out. We got a whole other half to play, and you're going to play in it. Georgia Tech, the opponent, after the game said, this guy Roy came out and was an animal. He is hitting everybody. He was making more tackles than anybody else. He almost won the game for Cal. He was incredible because he was a changed man. He had been given a second chance and he had become a person of worth in his eyes. Onesimus has become a person of worth because someone paid a price for that. and making it happen. So I'm sending you my very heart back to you, he says. Paul couldn't go to Colossae. He's in prison in Rome. He clearly couldn't go. So he's sending his representative instead. He's saying, what he's saying is this, the way you treat Onesimus is the way you treat me. He is as my very heart. Notice that Paul uses the word heart in verse 7, verse 12, and verse 20. This is personal. He's really feeling it. He is essentially saying, when I'm sending him, I'm sending my very self. That's how invested I am in this. So that brings us to verse 13. I would like to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while in chains. So I just want to remind you of the scene a little bit. If you were to look in Acts 28, go to verse 30, you would see that Paul, at the very end of the book of Acts, is left in prison in Rome. Now, he was familiar with dungeons. All you have to do is read Acts 16. But in this case, it says he was in a rented house for 2 years, and he had people coming and going with a Roman guard there. So Onesimus could have easily visited him, as others would have, while he's in this house. And he could have helped him in very practical ways. But notice that he has become useful. He is actually helping me. He's actually making a contribution to the kingdom. But notice he is taking your place, Philemon, which puts Philemon and Onesimus in terms of social standing and contribution and usefulness in the same place. See what he's just done? He said, this guy's status, Onesimus, has significantly changed. I regard him so highly that I regard him like you. So what is Philemon going to do with that? And oh, by the way, I'm in chains. I just want to remind you again, I've already said it, but I am in chains for the gospel. Is there a more noble task? In other words, I'm going to ask you to do something really hard. You're going to have to take the slave back. But think about my situation as I'm sitting here in chains for the gospel. It's far more arduous, far more challenging. And I'm not asking you to take up a hardship worse than the one I'm going through. Verse 14, but I don't want to do anything without your consent. I'm not going to force you. He wants it to be voluntary. He's not going to work him. He's not going to try and manipulate him. He's not going to try and get something out of him. He's not going to try and force him. It would really be a breach, a violation of Christian relationships, Christian love, a fellowship, etc., if he were to do that. He wants him to make his own decision. His overriding concern is that Philemon would be free enough in Christ to make the decision to do the right thing. But notice he still hasn't mentioned what he wants Philemon to do. He's slowly working up to it. He's persuading in stages. And when he gets to verse 15, he kind of mentions it's perhaps the reason that he was separated from you for a while was that so you might have him back forever. So he's working a couple things here. On the one hand, he's saying separated. And the next thing to say is forever. Then he says for a little while. And then he says, have him back. And he's working two different things there. He's saying, you know, he was gone for a while, but you're going to have him back forever, which is a long time. And on the other hand, he works another contrast, right? That it was separated, but you're having him back. That may be, in other words, through all of this, Paul is humbly suggesting that God is doing something. Have you ever had a set of circumstances or things happen in your life and you wonder, what was that all about? Might have been good, might have been bad, but you're kind of confused. I mean, was God in this? Is this a God thing? Is this just circumstances? And you're only really wise or smart about this much later when you figure out and see what God was doing. In this situation, Philemon is probably having some strong feelings and they're probably not really good. So his ability to see what God is doing may be obstructed a little bit. Paul is trying to get him to slow down and see, hey, you know what? Maybe this is a God thing. Maybe God is doing something here. Maybe there's something of divine intention. Maybe there's a divine appointment here. Maybe there's something significant that God is doing. And it's similar, by the way, to Joseph's story in Genesis, where in chapter 45 and chapter 50, when Joseph is introducing himself back to his brothers in 45. He says, don't be distressed. Don't be angry for selling me and sending me here. It was for saving lives that God did this. Now I see after all these years, 12 years in prison, by the way, or as a slave. And now I'm beginning to see what God is actually doing. It wasn't you who did this. God did this. And it was only for a moment. And in chapter 50 of Genesis, he says the same type of thing, that it was only for a season, but God is doing something important here. Let's catch what God is doing. Because I want you to accept him back. Now he gets to it. No longer as a slave, verse 16, but better than a slave, a dear brother. He's very dear to me. And even dearer to you, both as a fellow man, as a brother in the Lord. Wow, that's quite a statement. By the way, we're 16 verses into this letter. This is the first time he's used the word slave. And he wants to receive him back in such a way. He's not forcing him to say, okay, I want you to free him. I want you to make him a freed man. He's not saying he's no longer to be a slave. He's not saying I want you to free him immediately upon his return. Rather, what he's sort of saying is, love God and the person right in front of you, and then make your decision. Love God and the person in front of you, and now make your decision. Because I don't see how you can look at him just as a slave. I mean, he may remain a slave or not, I don't know, but he can't be regarded as a slave anymore. There's a change that's been effected of him, independent of whether he's legally freed or not. There's a change of worth. There's a story about an old silver miner who worked relentlessly, obsessively to find silver. He was going to strike it big. And he was so obsessed with this that his wife and children finally left him. They were like sick and tired of him. When he died, fellow miners were cleaning up his little tent. And he had a note that said, hey, bury me in my cabin. He had bought a cabin years ago, and it wasn't far away. So they take his body, and they take it up to his cabin, and they remove the floorboards, and they begin digging, because they're going to literally bury him under his cabin. As they're digging, they come across this gray, lustrous material, and they begin to excavate more and more, and it grows bigger and bigger and bigger. His house was founded on an enormous vein of silver. All his life, he had been a multimillionaire, but he didn't know it. He didn't know he had built his cabin on a vein of silver, and he was incredibly wealthy. Paul is saying to Philemon, you have incredible wealth now. This guy comes back to you, he's useful. He's becoming his name. He's incredibly useful, and he's right there in your household now. Look at that. Pay attention to that. He's coming back better as a slave. You know, whether you choose to recognize it or not, he's more than a slave. He's a fellow man and a brother in the Lord. A fellow man, person created in the image of God, and he's a brother in the Lord. By the way, there is no religious fellowship organization or faith anywhere in the ancient Near East that would regard a slave and the master as equal footing in any religious system or anything else. So even to speak of him as being a brother in the Lord was outrageous. No one would ever even think this way. And the other interesting thing is, in verse 7 and verse 20, Paul has already called Philemon a brother. Now he's calling Onesimus the same thing. Once again, he's saying he's the same as you. In Christ, you guys are the same. Your relationship now, your earthly relationship now, is determined by your relationship with God. So how is it that you are useful? How do you see yourself as useful? Most of us, of course, feel like we need to be productive, we need to achieve, we need to be doing something to be useful, right? The only way I'm going to get approval from anybody is if, in fact, I produce something. You know, it's the story of getting a 98 on the exam and showing it to the parent, and the parent saying, well, where is the other, you know, what'd you do to the other 2% to make mistakes? I mean, what's the matter with you? Or anything like that where there's a demand on us to be useful. What is that like for you? Father God says to Jesus at his baptism, this is my son whom I love. Wait, Jesus hadn't done anything. No miracles, no teaching, nothing. And the Father says he loves him. Why? There's a relationship with the Father and the Son. Paul has described Onesimus as a son. He's part of the family now. So the usefulness now is based on love. That's the second thing. Paul knows of Philemon's love. He's talked about it already. He says that very attribute that you do so well at exhibiting as you lead the church at Colossae, that I need you to get in touch with again and use here. The usefulness is not based on your competency, on results, even Onesimus's results, but it's an entirely different measuring stick. It's one of the fruit of the Spirit. It's what God does. It's what he puts in us. It's what we need so desperately. We need love. That's how you're to look on him. Usefulness is based on change value. This guy was useless. He wasn't very good when you owned him as a piece of property. But now he has a changed sense of purpose and meaning. He's actually going to be a carrier of a letter to the church at Colossae at some point. Paul trusts him that much. And all those things he lacked prior to Christ, he's gaining in Christ. He's become useful to you, not just useful to me, Paul says, but also to you, Philemon. Give him a chance. Look at him that way. Give him an opportunity because there's a change that has happened. Usefulness, fourthly, is based on a changed standing. A changed standing. He has become my son. He is helping me. He will help you. He will be useful to you. Receive him back. The changed standing, he is a fellow man. Again, person created in the image of God and a brother in the Lord. The annals of human history record again and again how people have dehumanized other people, either out of culture, ethnic grounds, whatever it is, how we humans have enslaved, tortured, and murdered our fellow human beings. The gospel comes in and introduces something completely different. In the film Schindler's List, one of Spielberg's greatest movies, I believe Liam Neeson plays a German opportunist who jumps on the German war effort by getting cheap Jewish slave labor, those who would have been in the gas ovens otherwise, and he uses them to make money. But as the story unfolds, Oscar Schindler's begins to soften, and he begins to see these Jews as not just money-making machines for him, but as real human people that are useful in a different way. And he begins to design schemes to buy them and to protect them from being murdered. As he does that, at the end of the movie, the Allies are now coming into Germany, and Schindler will probably not be treated well by them, so he needs to leave. But the Jewish Holocaust survivors, those that have been his slaves and worked for him, also have recognized that he has saved their lives, and he has a different heart. And so Itzhak Stern, the foreman, along with all of them, present him with a ring. And here's the moment that you're going to watch on film.
There will be generations because of what you did.
I didn't do enough.
You did so much.
This car. Kurt would have bought this car. Why did I keep the car? 10 people right there. 10 people. And more people. This pin. 2 people. This is gold. two more people, you would have given me two for at least one. You would have given me one more. One more person. Person, Stan. For this. I could have gone. One more person. And I didn't. I didn't.
That final moment that you just watched, again, the ring has inscribed in it, he who saves one life saves the world entire. That is the entire word. It's a quote from the Talmud, if you didn't catch that. Paul has saved one life. Of course, he saved many more. But for the sake of this letter to Philemon, he saved one life. And he's asking Philemon to do the same. To see the worth, to see the value, to let Onesimus become useful for God's kingdom. May we treat others that same way. Let's pray together. Thank you, Lord, that before you we were lost, we were separated from God, that we had no story, no legacy, no inheritance that included you, Lord God. But it's through Christ that we are reconciled, drawn back into relationship with the Father, and we become useful because of a relationship, because of a changed status, a changed standing, because of love. We become useful to you, Father God, and to you, Christ Jesus, by the powering work of the Holy Spirit. So fill us and speak that truth to us yet again, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Bless you.
Thanks, Pastor Doug, for that message. And as we respond in worship, we're going to be, again, coming back to some songs about the cross. And as we remember just what Jesus has done, given us purpose, given us meaning, that we might be used for his purposes, that we might respond, not just today, but this week and in the weeks to come. So let's sing Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Did that grace appear the hour I first believed? My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. Mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope. my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever. You were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your Spirit is within me, because you died and rose again.
Let's sing that again. I'm forgiven.
And I'm forgiven, because you were forsaken. Accepted, you were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your Spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for? Forgiven, because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. The Spirit is within me, because you died and rose again.
Amazing love.
Amazing love. My King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you.
Sing amazing love.
Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you, and all I do, I honor you.
Sing, you are my King.
Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Let's sing that again. You are my King. And you are my King. And you are my King. And Jesus, you
thank you that you are truly our King. And Lord, it is your amazing love, we can't understand it, that our King would die for us. And Lord, as a result, it's our joy and privilege to honor you, to be useful for your work. And we pray that as you send us forth into the world this week, that we might honor you in all that we do, because you are truly our King. We worship you, God, in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
We have been so blessed by getting to worship with you this morning, and we want to continue fellowshipping with you at our after service fellowship. You can go ahead and log on using the link displayed below, starting right now, and this will go on until noon. So we hope to see you there, and we just want to thank you again for joining us this morning. Have a blessed week.
Glory to you.